Welcome to Jet City, everybody. We are very busy. The shop is a mess. We have a J79-15 right here and some other things. Starty's right there waiting for parts. But this is a response to, or a follow-up to, or the question and answer video following Compressor Stall. Now, we've had a wave of comments, but there's been much less critical acclaim or critical criticisms of my video than I expected. It hasn't been that bad. However, there's been one group of people that have been especially upset with me. So I'm going to move the issue that they're talking about to the front of the line from number 9 to number 1. Let's go to number 9. Okay. It was about my comment about to fly slow, you decrease the angle of attack. I worded that improperly. So the comment, one of the comments was, Agent JZ, slow flight is as practiced in general aviation, involves increasing the angle of attack and increasing power, short of the critical angle at which the wing stalls. Yes. In my example, using an aircraft flying slowly, I should have said something like, I should have said this. When you're flying slowly, you must maintain a lower angle of attack, otherwise you'll stall. Now, I don't mean flying slowly with massive amounts of power and huge angles of attack. That's not what the airfoils in the engine do. There's a speed they're traveling, and at any given speed, you have an allowable maximum angle of attack. And as you are flying slower in an airplane, as you're flying slower and slower, your maximum angle of attack is less. Otherwise, you'll just fall out of the sky. So I ask you pilots, you airline pilots, you people who are so upset with me, what happens when you're traveling at a speed, whatever speed you're in your plane, and you increase the angle of attack without increasing power or speed? Well, you start to climb, then what? Then you increase it more, and then you fall out of the sky. In the example that we were using, you don't have the option of increasing power. We were doing it as the rotor of a gas turbine engine at a given speed. At a given speed. So that's the speed you've got, that's the wind flowing over the airfoil, and there is a maximum speed with which, or a maximum angle of attack you can use at that speed. If you go above that, it stalls. That's exactly what I was trying to say. So my apologies to the pilots out there that are thinking too much about airplanes and not enough about engines, but this was about engines. Okay, we're back with a new battery in our microphone, so we won't lose our audio this time. Okay, now there is an index to a playlist I have called Your Questions Answered. And if I haven't answered your question in the comments in any particular video after a couple of days, it's probably because that answer has had a video response in the past, and it's in that index, and I suggest you check it. So if you can take a look at that index before you type a question, that would make life easier for me and for you, because it's already there. Okay, now a question from Billy Nomates, 1974, which is actually a whole bunch of questions. He snuck a bunch in there. We've heard from Billy Nomates, 1974 before. He asks, do you have to perform some stalling testing as part of your engine testing? And then he goes, I could see maybe a test that you checked that the variable inlet guide vanes correctly adjust to an inlet air upset. Upsetting the inlet air to a jet engine is very difficult. It's not something we can do at all on the ground. So no, we don't test that. The way we know that the VIGVs are in sync is the engine doesn't stall. The adjustments that we can make are on the rod end of the hydraulic actuators. There's one on this side and one on the other. We have to make sure that the signal being sent to the cylinder is appropriately timed with the length of that rod. If it's a bit lazy, in other words, if the VSVs and the IGVs are opening a little bit later in the RPM range, we can extend this rod and make the timing slightly more aggressive. So that's something you do when the engine's not running. And there you go. We can adjust that, but we adjust it to the point where we're making full power. And we can tell that it's not too aggressive because it's not stalling. If it starts to stall or starts to warble like a near stall, we know to back it off a quarter of a degree or whatever. But if we back it off too far, then the engine doesn't make full power. So that's how you know if they're synchronized properly. You want to get as much power as possible without going a little too far. So that's kind of how that works. So Billy No Mates also says, could you elaborate on the fact that a stall happens because of what is in front of the blades, not behind? Yes, it's the air being encountered by the blades and the angle at which it is hitting the blades that determines whether or not the blade will function or stall. So things that it is encountering are things in front of it that are coming at it. Once it's gone past it, it's got nothing to do with the blade. When an airplane's flying, it matters what's in front of it, not what's behind it. What's behind it is in the past. What's ahead of it is in the future and approaching the present very soon. It's the only way I can explain it. There you go. The pressure does not build up behind one stage of a compressor because the stage behind it is busy scooping that air and shoving it backwards. The compressor rotor, each stage is moving air that way. Let's see if that's the back and this is the front. The air is coming in. The air doesn't pile up behind any one stage because the stage behind it is doing its job as well. It's like almost like a bucket brigade. If one of them stops, then yeah, the whole process falls apart, but they are all doing their job, and that's the way it goes. And the third question by Brian Cox, maybe the internationally renowned astrophysicist, but I'm not sure. When testing engines, do you ever induce a stall while setting up the variable stator system? How do you know anti-stall system is correctly set up? This is just another version of the same question that Billy No Mates just asked. No. If the angle of attack of the blades is insufficient, like we covered last time, you're giving up a lot of compression and giving up a lot of power of the engine. So you want the IGVs and the VSVs to give the maximum allowable angle of attack to get the most air compressed possible. So you measure that it's at the right angle by two things. You balance off the fact that it's not stalling, because then you'd be going too far, but it is making full power, because if it's not making full power, you didn't go far enough. And when I say too far and not far enough, it's about the angles we talked about in the last video that was so controversial. Okay. Fourth response is, one thing you didn't comment enough on was what happens to a turbine engine on an airline that stalls and surges. In every instance, does the engine need to be torn down or inspected after a stall or surge? Or can a pilot continue to fly? This is by Willie Gilly. And this is a long answer because every stall is different. I know I didn't really answer that question, but that's not really my department. If we stall an engine, if we were to stall one of these in the test cell, we'd shut it down. We would reset the IGVs. One of the things that we do is the computer calculates a desirable angle of the VSVs. There's a protractor. On this engine, it's right on the bottom because it's out of a Phantom. On the other engines, it's right on the top. I've shown videos of the protractor moving while we're throttling up the engine. Let's take a look at that now. Okay, that protractor reads out in a vernier scale of the degrees of deflection of the IGVs and the VSVs. That number needs to match the computer calculated, what's called the calculated VSV position. And it's on our computer. It says, it's in the bottom right, sometimes you can see it. I'll see if I can show you that. It says calculated VSV position and actual VSV position. We want those to match. So if it's way off, the engine might come to a verge of a stall, but no, I don't have any footage of a stalling engine in our test cell because the guys that build those engines and the girls that build those engines are pretty good at their job. Just as an aside, this is a J79-15, which is interesting because So is that one. And you can't really see that picture very much right now, but because it's in the background, but it was featured in a video called Full Power in the Rain. Go have a look, you'll probably enjoy it. That's a dash 15 in the poster, and this is a dash 15, so they match exactly. Not the exact same engine, but the same type of engine. And now we get to the Quantum Freak. The Quantum Freak asks, could you explain a little more detail the bleed air system, or the air bleed system? Is the air bled in between compressor stages? How is it done practically? Practically. Well, air does not bleed into the compressor because it's a compressor. It compresses air. And air at a higher pressure always will flow to an area of lower pressure, which if there was a hole in the case, it'll blow out. And there's a manifold right here with a line. This is seventh stage. I think it's seventh stage bleed air. And it is used, there's a couple of lines over here. We'll bring the camera over and take a look at this. It's used to cool the rear bearing, which is way back here. There's a surrounding air chamber around the sump. It doesn't actually cool the bearing, but it protects it from heat, is another way of saying it. There's a chamber of pressurized air around this bearing sump, and that is pressurized with seventh stage bleed air to protect it from the heat of combustion and fire and all that stuff back there. Bleed air manifold here, and a couple of pipes externally routed to, one goes into the center bearing casing, the other one goes all the way back to the rear bearing housing, the rear frame. So that is always on. And another bleed air system is right here. This is going to be, I think, CDP, compressor discharge air. And it goes to the blown flap system on the Phantom. These are vents from what we call E301, which is, this is the pressure behind the compressor rotor. There is holes in the compressor shaft up here. They take air through the shaft. They escape behind the last stage of the compressor. And there's a seal around there. And then there's the midframe. So that pushes the whole compressor rotor forward with air pressure, and the air that leaks past that seal, the rotating seal, which is about this big around, comes out here. Okay. And there's also a video that I made called Bleed Air, which talks about the various different types of air being bled off the compressor of a gas turbine engine. They're all called bleed air, and they're all different things. And so it's the same name for different things. It gets confusing. It's lots of fun. All right. Now, Martin Nedkulkov, Nedkulkov, I suppose. He asked, do variable bleed valves and variable stator vanes move constantly to adjust and compensate, or do they have preset positions depending on engine condition and thrust requirements? Not thrust requirements. Engine RPM and inlet air temperature determine their position. There is a range up to idle where nothing much happens, and then from ground idle to flight idle and a little bit past, they're variable. Once you get to the high power regime, they're wide open. So there is a range of engine RPMs that they do vary. The textbooks I recommend go a lot into this, and I can't really go into a detailed explanation of all that stuff, but there are equations involved, and I promised you that last video would involve no equations, so we tried to keep our promise. But yes, there is a range of engine operating parameters that they are changing. Okay, Donald Dowdy, on one topic you could have touched a little better, how does the engine determine VSV angle? Is it compressor RPM only or other inputs? It's other inputs, and it's compressor inlet temperature and RPM. And we joked about this last time. Where is it? Oh, there it is. This little thing. That's your compressor inlet temperature sensor, CIT we call it, CIT. And it's right at the very inlet of the engine. You can see it in this one. We showed it on that one. You can see it in all of our engine tests. That has a fluid inside it that expands and contracts and has a micro adjust in the fuel control that compensates for inlet air temperature. Inlet air temperature indicates air density, and engine RPM is like what we just talked about. So the CIT sensor, there's the wires right here. It's right there in this engine. This is one from a J79 that's been cut, so it's dead, unfortunately. It's kind of cool. All right. Those are the two main parameters for determining VSV position. And now, the best one of all. We'll sign off with this. Number 10, by the power of Yaos. Yaos. With the authority of an engineering degree and several gas turbine textbooks, I can say that this info is all exactly on point. Excellent job. Thank you, the power of Yaos. The power of Yaos. The power of Yaos. From the Jet City Turbines Jet Engine Workshop with a variable stator J79-15 in front of a picture of a J79-15 on the day after Remembrance Day. Thanks for watching.